So the next name on the list of Phillips carbs is Lipsy. It's the same Lipsy of Lipsy crystal. So Lipsy, early 1970s. Earlier, we talked about the Phillips curve where explanation was given in terms of market imperfections. So what Lipsy tried is something else. He tried to, so Lipsy shows market mechanism behind the Phillips curve. So that was his idea. So what was it? He says that the process of determination, of nominal wage rate is connected to labor market equilibrium. That is, we are talking about labor demand and labor supply. So labor market equilibrium and how they are connected. Labor market equilibrium, that is labor demand and labor supply. So how is it? So according to Lipsy, what is the scenario? W dot, that is the change in nominal wage. W dot is equal to F of LD minus LS divided by LS. So this is our second form of Phillips curve. And there are two things to note. Note number one is that when in equilibrium, LD equals LS, it implies that F0, because this will be zero, so F0 equal to zero, that is W dot equal to zero at LD equal to LS. So when I'm observing equilibrium in the labor market, wage inflation becomes zero, okay? So that was the first thing. There is something else also. Number two is to exploit this equality. LD greater than LS, which is basically excess demand for labor. It implies W dot is greater than zero, so implies wage inflation. So it gives us the same result that we have observed in the Phillips curve, but in terms of labor demand and labor supply. Obviously, it does have certain problem. We'll talk about that right now. So LD less than LS implies W dot negative. So that means excess supply of labor implies wage deflation. Okay. So what we have here is the same idea achieved through market mechanism, that is market equilibrium, instead of size of the labor union. Okay. Now, obviously, there is a problem, as I was saying. So problem of this one, two. What is the problem of two? So what is the problem? The problem is of the following kind. It relates W naught, what is this? This is nominal wage inflation with labor demand and labor supply. That itself is the problem. Why? Because they are, so which are planned magnitude, right? In equilibrium, they are equal. So what you observe is the equilibrium value of labor employment. But this scenario before equilibrium, they are obviously planned magnitude. So when I'm saying excess demand for labor or excess supply of labor, I'm talking about planned magnitude, right? But nominal wage is observable, right? But these are planned magnitude, hence unobservable. But Phillips curve was based on empirical data. So I am explaining something that is observed, that relation, with unobservable things, and I am creating a function which connects unobservable values with something which is observed. That is a big problem. That actually makes the thing kind of meaningless. So what to do? Hence, to connect with reality, that is things that can be measured, Lipset introduced the following function. What is that? LD minus LS divided by LS is some phi of u, where phi dash u is less than zero. That is trivial because this we are talking about is unemployment rate. So when demand is more than supply, what will happen to unemployment? It will be higher. And when demand is less than supply, so oversupplied, okay, so that gives me that phi dash u. No, I stated just the opposite thing. Sorry. So when labor demand is more than labor supply, that means people who are asking for work, they will be employed, right? So unemployment rate will reduce. Okay, so let me just write it. So when labor demand is more than labor supply, unemployment rate reduces. And when labor demand is less than labor supply, I don't want people working, so unemployment rate will increase. Okay, and now to connect the reality with the reality, keeping labor market equilibrium in the middle, what will I do? So my W dot is F of phi of u, okay? Where, if you look at the differentiation, then f dot phi dot is negative. All right. So this is, I'll say this is the third one. This is actually the Phillips curve as proposed by Lipset, after adjusting for the unobservable labor demand and labor supply. Now we will take a look at the Phillips curves diagram, that which was obtained by Phillips. And we'll make some comparison. So Phillips curve is basically very simple looking, okay? This is the original Phillips curve. So here we have W dot, here we have unemployment, and what we have here is this. And as I was saying, that this is the intercept relating U equal to UN, which is the natural rate of unemployment. Now, obviously I have drawn a single Phillips curve and this is a hand waving. So if you look at the diagram, what it basically means that at some point A, U equal to UN, the natural rate. Okay. And there, W dot equal to zero. So wage inflation falls to zero. So we have seen that. But if I compare this result with this one, then combining with three, that is equation three, W dot equal to zero when labor market is in equilibrium, LD equal to LS. But if labor market is in equilibrium, then what is this natural rate of unemployment? What kind of unemployment we are really talking about here? Okay, because matching these two, it says that there will be some unemployment even at the equilibrium. And that is specifically the idea of natural rate of unemployment. So combining with three, W, we have, what do we have? We have labor demand equal to labor supply does not imply that unemployment is zero, but unemployment is positive and it's equal to natural rate. Okay. So that's what it basically means. But then, if at natural rate of unemployment, labor market is in equilibrium, it also says that we cannot go further. And that is a very strong statement to say. So what does it imply? It implies that even when labor market clears, there remains some unemployment. This is known as frictional unemployment. This is known as frictional unemployment. And because we are talking about the amount, and it is said that unemployment is at its natural rate. So this is the natural rate of unemployment. But how do we possibly explain that? So if there is unemployment even in labor market equilibrium, then what is the kind of equilibrium that we are looking at? It's not the usual equilibrium of demand and supply. It has some layer in it. So what is that? So the explanation goes like this. Labor market comprises of two things, actual unemployment and unfulfilled vacancies. So we'll symbolize it as LD equal to E plus V. V stands for vacancies, Roman 1. Then this will be not labor market, this will be labor demand, sorry. So labor demand comprises of actual unemployment and unfulfilled vacancies, and labor supply comprises of simply labor employed and unemployed. So that is coming from the book, labor employed and unemployed. That is LS equal to E employed plus U, and it becomes our Roman 2. Hence, at equilibrium, LD equal to LS implies V equals U. That is our unfulfilled vacancies is equal to the unemployment. And this is what frictional unemployment really stands for. Why such an explanation is acceptable? Because to have zero unemployment, even in theory, is to assume that the skills that are required by the vacancies are exactly the skills of the people asking for employment. Now that accepting that is basically ignoring the sheer power of randomness. That if we, even if I randomly match, there will be some vacancies for which the applying laborers, their quality or skills will not match. So the imperfect match, the error inbuilt, creates this unemployment. Okay. And obviously, as the number of unfulfilled vacancies is positive, as the number of unfulfilled vacancies is positive, so is the positive rate of unemployment, comma, known as natural rate of unemployment. Natural rate of unemployment. So this is how we have covered Lipsey and explained what we actually mean by this word. So that is how the labor market idea of Lipsey goes at par with the idea of natural rate of unemployment and the scenario at which wage inflation reduces to zero. Okay, so now we will go to the second improvement, which is by Friedman and Phelps. And I think they got the Nobel Prize. I think. But as far as I remember, Phillips Carr actually got two Nobel Prizes. Okay, and Friedman and Phelps start from a very basic argument. The argument is this: in microeconomics, labor demand and labor supply are connected to, remember the input market diagrams, they are connected to real wage and not nominal wage. So the explanation may seem good, but connecting labor demand and labor supply to nominal wage basically breaks down the idea of input market that we have. But again, after breaking that down, you can't refer to that market always to provide the explanation for the Phillips curve. So how to adjust that? So given that, microeconomics tells us that labor demand is a function of W by P and it is negatively sloped. And labor supply is a function also of W by P, but it is positively sloped. So this much we know from microeconomics. But as I said, that in deriving Phillips curve, it was assumed that these are functions of nominal wage. So that's where things went wrong. So that means the relevant independent variable the relevant independent variable will be WIP, that is our real wage, and not W. So the possible relation between the wage inflation and unemployment rate and unemployment rate comma if any will be the following. So what is that? Not W dot, but W by P dot equal to phi of U, where phi dash is negative. So that's the kind of relation that you can safely say. So what does it say? It says that, so this is rate of change of real wage. This is rate of change of real wage. And this is unemployment rate. So these two are negatively related. So now we have when we went to theory, what we ended up with, a relation of this kind, rate of change of real wage is negatively related to unemployment rate. Okay. But then again, after reaching this point, we cannot, you know, restrict ourselves from using sticky wage model. And what do we learn from sticky wage model? Sticky wage model also says that the bargaining is done over a nominal wage, that is true, but keeping a target real wage in mind. Keeping a target real wage in mind. Right? Again, as contracts are signed at discrete intervals, what happens is the target real wage is decided over expected price level. That is our PE, and not actual price level. Not actual price level. Why? Because simply they don't know. They don't know what will happen in future. So that means this P has to be changed to expected price. If we really are eager to include the bargaining process, then we know that the bargaining process is based on a target real wage, and that target real wage connect to expected price. So let me mark it as 4. Hence, 4 changes to, what do you have now? W by PE dot, which is equal to phi U. Since it's a dot, I can always use the power of log. So W dot minus PE dot equal to phi of u, which gives me w dot is equal to phi of u plus pe dot. This becomes my fifth equation. And what is the name of this equation? This is expectation augmented Phillips curve. This is expectation augmented Phillips curve. Okay. But now we have a structure where W naught is a variable, phi u is also a variable, and PE dot is also there. And obviously, if I am going to draw or look at a relationship between these two, I have to take PE dot as given, right? In equation 5, if I have to draw a relationship between W dot and phi u, then I have to take PE dot as given. But if I take PE dot as given, that means there can be so many values of PE dot. That means by this equation, we are looking at a set of Phillips curve and not just a single Phillips curve. Each Phillips curve correcting to a different expected price, or sorry, expected inflation. So we can now have a family of Phillips curve, each relating to different values of PE dot. Okay, so slowly we are trying to reach a point or the variables rather which had a huge role also in ADAS. Okay, now the third one, and this one is by Samuelson, that is our Paul Samuelson and Solo from growth theory. Samuelson and Solo. Okay. So what they say is that in labor market, real wage is determined by W by P equal to MPL, and here we'll write it FL. Which says, going to the dot culture, W dot minus P dot, because we'll take log, right? So W dot minus P dot equal to FL dot, which tells me that P dot is basically W dot minus FL dot. Okay. So let's carry on. Now, if we take, so assume FL dot as a constant, The reason is very simple. FL dot to some extent relates to the technology, right? Also, marginal productivity or labor. So if I say take that FL itself is changing, that means productivity itself is changing, and that will relate to some technological improvement. But if I bring in the ground of technological improvement, then justifying the unemployment rate only on the basis of wage inflation or price inflation, it will become very difficult, because every technological improvement will obviously affect the labor employment. So assume FL dot as a constant, that is FL dot equal to some A. Okay, so this is a constant. Then what will happen? Earlier we had W dot equal to phi of u plus p dot, but now we have W dot equal to FL dot plus p dot equal to phi of u, that is p dot. In that sense, we can write p dot equal to phi of u minus a, because FL dot is a, plus p dot. And to adjust, we can actually assume a equal to zero, or combine these two constant and just write like this: p dot equal to phi of u plus p dot. Obviously, where f dash is less than zero. And what is this? This is price augmented Phillips curve. So now we do not have wage inflation at all. Price augmented Phillips curve. And having this, we actually connected inflation, that is actual inflation, with unemployment. And there is a small gap, and that gap is coming from this fact. Gap between expected inflation and actual inflation is connected by unemployment rate. So that's what we are saying, right? Now look at this equation. Looking at this equation again, we cannot restrict ourselves but going into the possibility of long run. And that's what Friedman did. He said that in the short run, such a gap is admissible. But in the long run, we have seen that they are the same. But if they are the same, then long run basically says that phi u equal to zero, right? So this is the equation which brought the idea of two Phillips curves. One is the short run Phillips curve, and the other is the long run Phillips curve. Okay, so let us just write a bit on that. Okay, and in passing, let me mark it as equation 6. So if I change equation 6 in this fashion, we can easily introduce the long run idea. So in the long run, rather I'll write like this. The deviation between expected price level and actual price level then leads to changes in unemployment rate. But this means, since in long run, the expectation or the expected price level equals with the actual one, and here starts the result. What is the result? There is no relation between inflation and unemployment in the long run. So there is no relation between inflation and unemployment at the long run. Reason is simple, as long run is when the economy, is at P equal to PE. This is something by which we define long run itself. And by that definition, in the long run, there cannot be any relationship between inflation and unemployment. So we have got a result. What is the result? In short run, Phillips curve, I'm writing PC, Phillips curve is negatively sloped. But in long run, PC is vertical with phi of u equal to 0 or u equal to un. So this is where we finish today. Okay.